Okay, so in this video, we're going to talk about the Lost Vault, kind of our overall thoughts of it, just give a review from the builders of it. This is Ben Oxenford, I'm Jesse Bourne, and this is Josh Gant, and the three of us collaborated to build this puzzle box. Okay, to solve the Lost Vault of Jesse James, where you're going to want to start is on the top. Pull them down and then slide the top forward a little bit, and then you pull this up, next one, top comes forward even farther, and then you'll find this bullet. Now the shape of this bullet has been modified so it works as a tool later. Behind the mask is a hidden face, under the palm is a stolen, and to complete the riddle you would say ace or the rhyme there. And what we have is a decoder ring. And so in here you have letters, and outside here you have numbers. So if I plug in ace here, if I point this arrow to that arrow, I get A equals 40. Now if I rotate to C and I start to spell out ace, I get C equals 32, and then E equals 1. So ACE equals 40, 32, 1. So if I come around, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn this 3 times and I'm going to stop at 40, just like that. And I'm going to turn past 32 once, and I'm going to stop at 32 the second time. And then I'm going to turn right to 0. And at that point, the handle will come down and the door will open. So in here, you have the deck of cards. So as you see, this foot comes out like that. Then you have this piece of newspaper, which is a copy of the City Times. And we actually made that up ourselves. It's not actually an exact copy of a newspaper from that time circa, but it talks about the Jesse James outlaw gang, some other anecdotes there. Inside the box in the back, you can see this revolver chamber. And if you put the bullet in here, you can actually use it to unlock this. But now we need a key for this. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a card and stick it into this right here. And then the drawer will pop open. Got a train ticket and a key, so we can use that key to get the drawer out. Start off with you, Josh. What do you think of the box?
I really like this box a lot. So of course I like all of them, right? But I like this one especially because it's not overly complicated, but yet it's very intricate in all the solving mechanisms. There's a lot of things to solve. There's a lot of journey that kind of brings you on, I think, as far as like where you go through the box, and I'm sure we'll go through that later, but you get to go through a lot of different compartments, you get to find a lot of things. It really takes you on a bit of a journey, and you really I don't know. It's fun to solve, and that's one of the things that I like about it the most. It's nothing's really super complicated or anything like that, but it's fun to solve, and that's all I would say about it. That'd be my favorite part.
From my perspective, it's been nice to come up with a 3D printed box, because you know this is the first 3D printed box that we've ever made for sale, and I haven't been around 3D printers that much. But we were able to combine 3D printing with laser cutting, and laser cutting is also pretty new to me. And, you know, we also have brass turning on there, lathe, you know, CNC lathe work. We used all three of those functions, and so we're able to combine a lot of value into the box. This box will be known for its puzzle experience and value, just because we're kind of using the best of all worlds and combining them in manufacturing. So that's my basic take.
I think this box has been fun to work on, and I've solved the design parts. And as far as the puzzle part of it, I think it's really neat how it all fits in a theme really well. And I think some of those were almost not even intentional, but we can talk about the different parts of it. There's the, even the bullet and the, there's the chamber inside, and it all fits together. And I think it's a really nice story in a box.
Mm-hmm. You know, one thing that I like a lot, and I know you worked on this quite a bit, is the weight of it. That is like, okay. It's nice the weight. If you picked up the box and it felt like a really light thing, you would think it were cheap. But because of the weight, it makes the value more, I think, in my mind anyway. Because it's not like some, extrusion printed thing where they're trying to save every bit of money, so they cut it down to the thinnest amount of material that they can, and they're producing millions of them. It's not that. You can tell as soon as you pick it up that that's not what this is.
Yeah.
So that's one thing that I think is pretty neat. There's a lot of things, but I'll think of another one while you guys talk about it.
So it's obviously the filament weighs quite a bit more, the metal filament. Mm-hmm. I haven't actually weighed the whole box either.
You could talk about that. I don't know if you explained that yet.
It took a while to kind of figure out a way to do it, but there's four parts that have kind of dead space in them. I wanted to use that to give it the feel of an actual metal safe. And one of them is this door interior. Those are two different parts, but in between those is some holes where we could fill it with plastic. So it has like a twisted fill of plastic that actually has a path that goes all the way through. So we fill one side in it until it comes out the other. And then similarly, behind these wood panels, they have certain holes in places where you wouldn't see them, where we can inject the plaster into one side and it goes through the path and comes out the other side. Same with this side, and then finally the back. There's not much space in the top and the bottom.
So I'm pretty sure, you know, I think I came up with the design in the fall of 2020. And then I showed it to you in the fall of 2021. But at that time, anyways, when I showed it to Ben, basically we just had the basic safe dial on the front, this wall, which, you know, spoilers alert, came up, and then there was a little drawer down here. And that was basically the only thing I had. Everything else was added onto that. And, you know, Josh pointed out at one time that pretty much a puzzle seems to be best. You start with a concept that's, you know, basic and simple, but you're like, well, that's a solid concept, and then you can just build around that. But, you know, we've gone through quite a bit, few designs where we kind of don't know what's the basic thing of the box, and we kind of beat around the bush trying to figure out what we're going to go with.
Yeah, we're like, we're going to build a box, and then we start like, oh, this will be a mechanism, this will be a mechanism, this will be a mechanism, and then we get through making this really complicated thing, designing up, and we're like, but what's the point? Like, what's going on here? And it definitely helps when there's a theme or a general mechanism that's centered around.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting how that comes about. It's not like, all right, we've got this idea and it has all these parts to it, and like you guys are working on this over a period of time and just coming up with to it, and it all fit together. So.
Yeah. Thinking about it, you mentioned earlier, and I was going to say something, how it all fits together, like the bullet goes with like the theme, and the card goes with the theme, and it all kind of has a theme. But I remember thinking about that, we thought about that for a long time, like, what are we going to put in it? Like, we thought of the bullet eventually, but it was like a long time to figure out what we were going to, like, what everything was going to be as far as the components in it.
Nuances. I mean, I'm surprised Ben hasn't brought up this foot stick. This was all Ben right here.
Okay. Oh, okay. So we were trying to fit this deck of cards in, and it was different. I'm just trying to find way to fit them, and at some point this light bulb came on, and the deck of cards is just the size of the box, but it wouldn't fit with the drawers that we had, and I thought, if I could just get rid of this piece of plastic right here, maybe we should take this whole frame out, but it looks so nice with the little steps that it looks like a safe. Mm-hmm. And at some point I realized, well, we can take it out, it could be part of the solve. And then you have to pull this little foot down to get the cards out.
It works real good. I mean, I think that stumps quite a few people. Like, for me, it stumped me for a little bit. I was like, well, I can see that this is flexing. And I was like, what's the deal? And then finally, it's kind of an awkward thing to grab this and just move it down like that, because it's like, why would anybody do that? It looks like such a solid joint. So we try to keep this thing from, the door actually has a little notch in here so that when the door is closed, it should be very hard to pull it out from the bottom. And this one, you can't. Some of them, maybe you could if you had enough finger strength. But another neat thing is this drawer here actually needs you to take out a card from the deck. And it's almost like a double meaning for the ace. Put the card in above here, and then the drawer pops out. And that was Robert Yarger's idea. That's always another thing we try to do, is to give people very few tools that they can potentially just set down and lose. Because, each tool we put into the box, each moving part, we try to give it as much usage in the box as possible. Or use it twice if possible. So, that tied in the bullet really well, because for one thing, I think before we even had a use for the bullet, we were just going to put one in here just because it's a cool thing to have in a Western box.
And originally, this was going to be a magnet tool. So we were looking for, or some kind of magnet. We were looking, trying out these different kinds of magnets, and you wouldn't even have the hole. There's a hole in the back. So you're saying let's see if we can get the magnet to turn it, but it didn't have enough grip between the two different parts of the magnet to get that slider working.
I messed around with that for a while. It would have been cool though, because you wouldn't have seen anything on the inside.
Yeah, but here's something we hadn't thought about, is this iron filament has enough iron in it that's actually magnetic. So I don't know if that would have caused an issue too, because everything would be magnetic. You'd be sticking the magnet everywhere.
Right. So Ben has been printing boxes right from the get-go. He's got 20 odd printers right now, Prusa printers. Obviously, it just wasn't we printed the first one and everything was fine. You probably printed around 10 prototypes or something like that before we...
Yeah, and it's not just the whole box, but every part. For example, these last couple of days, I've been working on the hinges to just get, we had an issue with the... We're changing from screws to pins to as a fastener, and it just took a lot longer than I ever would have guessed, even though everything takes longer than I guessed.
So Ben does the printing, and then you also fill it with plaster, and then he also does the laser cutting. Right around the time we started producing them, you got a big laser.
Yeah, that was fun.
And so putting whole sheets on the laser and running these images on there, and the decoder rings, and then the dial on the front. And I have a small laser, but it'd be a lot more work.
Brass handle is an interesting feature. I mean, we tried printing some of those in plastic and it just wasn't working, so.
Yeah.
Maybe,
yeah, we thought that would be hard to do in brass, or at least I did kind of. I was like, if we can do it in 3D printing, that's good, because it's pretty fast and doesn't require a lot of labor, but it was always a question of how are we going to attach this to here and how much involved would it be. But Josh came up with the idea of doing a tapered mortise into this pin, and so that works really well.
Pretty much got that one first try, so that worked out.
Josh wrote the programs just by hand in his brain for cutting these on the CNC lathe. So these are milled out of solid brass. And then for these also,
Those are pretty simple because they're just bars, but there's so many bars. I mean, there's a lot of boxes, and then there's eight of these bars per box. So there's a lot of these things. And like, I think we figured it up as like a lot. There's over just this box. I think there's over like 10,000 parts, brass parts that need to be done on the lathe. So there's quite a few parts, and so we wanted to make it pretty fast. So these bars, we've got the machine pumping them out like every 11 seconds, I think it is. So it's just like cutting them off, moving it out, cutting it off, moving it out, cutting it off. So you just got to keep loading bars. We actually had all the programs to make everything, but then when we realized how many there were and how long this was taking, we're like, all right, let's go back through some of these and get them to go faster, because we needed to make them faster. So
after we have all the raw components, there's a few different people who do small sub-assembly parts. So we're at like 360 volts shipped at this point. Before we put the wood panels on, we spray it down with salt and water. We spray it down, we put it in a tub, let it sit for about 5 days, take it out, and then we glue the wood panels on. And then it needs to be lacquered, so we put 2 coats of lacquer on minimum. So that stops the rusting. So at that point, we check it over, we load it up with stuff. I check it over one more time, and then pack it up and ship it out. I just want to say one nuance we forgot to mention was there's actually a bearing in here for the handle and for here. And I thought that was a good addition. It just helps to make it a smoother feel. It doesn't feel like a cheap plastic knob or handle or anything.
So it's not like plastic turning on plastic.
Yeah, it's got a precision feel to it. That was a good upgrade, and I hope we can just continue to meld the worlds of printing, laser cutting, manufacturing, CNC, and also off-the-shelf components that help the box have a really good feel. And I'm excited for our next box to come out. Currently Ben's working a lot on the design. I hope we'll have that coming out sometime late this year. But it's been very good working on these boxes, and we've enjoyed it. And I hope you guys, I know a lot of you guys have really enjoyed the box and just all the puzzle into it. So we'll try to keep the puzzle level very high for these printed boxes in the future. Thanks for watching, everybody. I hope you enjoyed this review. Please leave a comment and let us know what the best favorite part of the video was and what you'd like to see more of. We like making these videos, and hopefully we'll have more in-depth sessions, possibly even before a box comes out. Maybe we could record some stuff about designing, all that kind of stuff. Whatever you guys want to see, basically, we just kind of want to give you some more content. So have a nice day, and we'll see you again soon. Goodbye.